Marcelo always gives a very impressive presentation that are hard to follow. And especially it's harder to follow when he's telling me the things I shouldn't be doing and I did anyway. So just as an outline, I'd like to talk about challenges of pursuing as health care professional education. So all of us, when we graduate from medical school, we could be clinicians, we could be investigators, we could be, and they always talk about the academic triad or the three-legged stool that has clinical, research, and education. But they just never tell us how to do this education part. There is a lot of training to become a researcher or clinician, but not very much about being an educator. So, like clinical practice, like research, there are competencies, yet they are not very well discussed. We don't get trained to acquire these competencies, let alone be evaluated on whether we acquired them or not. And then I will talk about models for promoting healthcare professions, education, competencies. And I will touch very briefly on scholarship in teaching and training. Why this is important? Or is this even important? Is this important topic? What do you guys think? I'm bothering you, keeping you here from listening you about the dialysis and transplantation. Is this important topic? So let's see if this is important. So here is the problem statement. There is no doubt that recent years have witnessed tremendous advances in knowledge, technology, innovations in clinical practice, and also increasing level of complexity of healthcare delivery systems. We were talking about the dialysis machines, which institute they go to, these negotiations and the reimbursement. How do we navigate through this as healthcare professionals? So when you have advances and the increasing level of complexity, then one would imagine that we would need reforms in healthcare professional education. And also require new curriculum, new pedagogies. Pedagogy is method of teaching and new forms of assessment, how we can assess students for these new competencies. And what makes things even a bit more complex is that implementing these changes in a curriculum really require faculty skill sets not typically developed in health professional schools. We don't, at least in my days, we didn't study this in medical schools. I didn't study it in my master or in my PhD. And typically not very covered in continuous professional development programs. Like, it is not a common subject when you go to the American Transplant Congress or, congresses to have sessions dedicated to medical education. So I'm going to ask you, and please don't be shy, but just by show of hand, who here think that they have the skills, knowledge, and attitude to be an effective educator? Most of you educate people, right? How do you guys do this if you don't think you have it? Okay, so let me ask you. I remember those who raised their hands. Who here received formal training in medical education? Okay, so what about the rest of you guys? Do you interact with the trainees or learners in any context? Any of you deals with residents, medical students? How do you do this? If you haven't received training, you don't think you are comfortable doing it. Okay, this actually is not very different than many. So these results are not surprising. What is surprising to me actually is that not many people raised their hands when I asked who think that they are effective educators. When we survey membership of the International Transplantation Society, 95% of the members who responded to the survey affirmatively said they think they have the knowledge, skills, and attitude to be educated. Okay? We asked them another question. So do you think this is important for the society to invest in? Should the society train transplant professionals of the membership in medical education? 97% said that yes. We thought that this was very interesting, and we actually submitted this in a presentation in the European Education Meeting, the Association of Medical Education in Europe. And we called it the paradoxical perceptions of healthcare professionals, because basically the two questions together, the response to two questions, imply that most of the mentorship think that this is something everybody needs to learn except themselves, okay? Which is really very interesting. So what are the challenges? One of the main challenges in medical education is presumed competence. Is that we are presumed to be competent as educators. We have competing professional commitments. We are between clinical and research. And we have misalignment between incentives to engage in medical education and professional recognition and promotion. So even until recently, and even in many institutes in the United States and Western Europe, it's much easier to get promoted for good research and to a lesser extent for your clinical practice or clinical excellence. It's much, much harder to get promoted for being an excellent educator. And also, how do we transition from just the day-to-day teaching activity into something that can be documented as scholarship and for which we can get recognized and promoted? So let's talk a little bit about presumed competency. I think some of you might have done animal research studies. And however it is in the United States or in Europe or everywhere, there is very extensive training you have to complete before you even touch the tail of a mouse. Okay? But what type of training you are required to do, even in the United States, before you start training healthcare professionals? It's very simple. You go to med school or pharmacy school or a school of soul. You graduate and voila, you are a medical educator, competent, deemed competent medical educator. And there has been studies that, so this is changing a little bit slowly, because now there are education programs, curriculum for training medical students as educators. And one of the interesting things that have been studied, that medical students who get trained in medical education, they become more effective learners of themselves. They learn better than students who have not been trained in this way. And along the same lines, there is also programs, similar programs for training residents as teachers. So what are the competencies? Because some would argue that these are things you can learn just by doing it. Learn on the go. So you can make a reasonable argument that you would learn if it is about selecting resources, you know, preparing material, deciding on learning objectives. Probably you can do this without much training. Possibly being learner-centeredness. This is probably would need some training, because we used to educator-centered teaching, where the professor or the expert just come to the lecture room and start imparting his wisdom on the students. Also, social communication and competency. But it's much harder to make an argument to that reflection and personal and advancement of personal teaching, that this is something we would learn on our own without being formally trained in this. Also, systems-related teaching, not just giving your part of the curriculum, whether it is physiology or renal block or what it is, but how that fits in the whole picture of everything the student is learning. And also, how you build on prior knowledge that the student come or the learner come to your education context with. So how all of this comes together? So, one of the things that we really need to be focused on when we engage in any training or teaching activity is that there are questions that we need to answer by engaging in any teaching or training activity. Do the learners really achieve the learning objectives set by the program? And what is the impact of training on practice? It's not just that they learn be demonstrable in their ability to practice? And what evidence can the program provide to demonstrate that they did so? How do we convince accrediting agencies for education that we are training physicians on what we claim we are training them on? How does the program demonstrate continuous improvement in its educational process? Because it's not enough to keep doing the same thing over and over and over for decades without ever changing it when the whole science and technology is evolving every day. So how people would acquire this? So there are models for promoting healthcare profession educator competencies. One of them is at our own institute. And actually, many of the universities in Egypt, and I imagine in most parts of the world, have a professional education. I looked up the website of Cairo University, and this is their website for faculty development. And there is, I know that there is one in Ain Shams University, and there are in other universities. And there are other institutes where they take it upon themselves to train people from other institutes where there aren't such programs. And this is a program at Harvard Macy Institute, at Harvard Medical School. And we thought in the TTS that in the International Transplantation Society that there are members who really do not have these opportunities, and whether it would be possible that the TTS could offer these opportunities to all its membership worldwide. And that came the idea of the Education Academy. And really, it is part of the mission of the Transplantation Society. I apologize that this is a bit smaller than what I thought. So it is non-for-profit NGO providing global leadership in transplantation, and its core mission includes the development of science and clinical practice, scientific communication, and continuing education and guidance on the ethical practices. So the possible solution could be that professional health societies, although they traditionally focused on clinical and scientific content, these societies play, members of these societies actually play important roles in education trainees and preparing the next generation of professionals in this discipline. And the Transplantation Society, as a multidisciplinary international society, established the Education Academy to address this gap. And the goals of this Education Academy was simple: to facilitate acquisition of knowledge, skills, and attitudes. So next time you ask if I received formal training, if you are a member of TTS, you say, yes, I did, because I took the Education Academy education course. And also to create a community of practice. One of the advantages you get from attending this conference is that you meet people of a like mind. People who are, if you are a nephrologist, you want to meet with other nephrologists and see what they are learning, managing their patients. This is what they call community of practice. So we thought that we created the same environment for those who are involved in medical education and training. And that would be a place for educators to exchange educational resources and innovations and best practices. And the last thing I would like to touch on is that how do we transition from our the things that we do anyway every day, like dealing with medical students, residents, fellows, how do we transform these educational activities into scholarship that we can publish about, we can present in a conference, we can get promoted for? So one of the criteria that is used to evaluate scholarship in teaching is Glassick's criteria. And these include clear goals. So for any educational activity, if you have a resident that is shadowing you, if you don't state upfront, it's like a contract between you and this resident. Here is what we're going to learn today. We're going to see this patient, so it is very explicit, it is determined, it is clear. That would constitute scholarship. If the plan is, we're going to go in and whatever we're going to see, that will be it. That actually doesn't qualify as a scholarship. Adequate preparation, like for example, reading the literature about what's new in this area. So it's just, you cannot be unprepared. That wouldn't qualify as a scholarship. You need to have adequate knowledge of the state of the science and research and the subject where you are being involved in education of students. students or residents with. Appropriate methods. So, for example, if you are testing communication skills, then probably a written exam about communication skills wouldn't be the best way to use for this. But probably observing a student who is interviewing a patient would be more appropriate to teach him and evaluate him on communication skills. Significant results. In an ideal world, you're always improving in your practice and you're evaluating what have you done differently and how did this improve the outcomes of the learning process. Effective dissemination. And this is the thing that I'd like to spend a couple of moments on. You have done all of this work. You have done all of this work. It is not scholarship unless you really publish it, unless you present it in a conference. Otherwise, nobody knows about it. Nobody, you miss this peer review step that allows you to critique yourself, understand what you could have done differently and better. And also reflective critique, where you evaluate yourself and have a plan for improving your own performance. So, way to present a lesson. So there are, you can present in your local institute. In an ideal world, you would have forums for presentation and exchange of practices around education. And there are international conferences for dedicated for special ed, for education, like International Association of Medical Science Educators and the Association of Medical Education in Europe, like the one you presented, the Paradoxical Perception Abstract. And recently, actually, TTS, we are very proud that TTS has a dedicated track for medical education. And if you attended the Hong Kong meeting or you're aware of it, there was actually a dedicated track for with abstract submission. When you are submitting an abstract, you can choose, for example, rejection, you can choose immunosuppression, but also you can choose education. And these are examples of the oral presentations that were presented. And you can see it came from all over the world. There was an abstract from Latin American Caribbean Transplantation Society about their interactive course. There was a presentation about transplantation leadership, TTS Transplantation Leadership Development Series project. There was a presentation from South Africa about teaching transplant of deceased donor donation through massive open online courses or MOOCs, and you get the picture. There was actually even an abstract here that talked about knowledge improvement results of European Mediterranean postgraduate program on organ donation, and it was collaboration between Egypt, Lebanon, and Morocco. And we will have the same thing, so I invite you between now and when we open the abstract submission for the TTS Congress in Seoul. If you have anything that you think would constitute educational scholarship, to submit an abstract to be presented in the Seoul meeting. I would like to just a couple of words about promotion for teaching efforts. You need to have clear goals and development plan as an educator. So this is not something you do after the fact or when you are submitting your portfolio. This is something you decide on when you start your career as an faculty person. You document your teaching productivity, which classes you taught, what committees you have been on, everything you do, number of hours, number of learners, and your role, whether you directed the course, you did educational leadership curriculum development, mentorship, advising, educational research. this is what we call the sunshine folder. Like you get a compliment from a student, so you keep it in there. You get a compliment from the dean for your outstanding performance. You keep all of these things. And you compete for honors and awards as an educator. All of these things count for promotions. They may not yet be here, but hopefully soon they will be. So, in summary, investing in building educator competency is critical in effective performance as transplant professionals. And scholarship in education is attainable.
Dear doctor, your time is up.